Hello again, viewers, and greetings, fellow space travelers. This is Thorn of Night, and welcome to part 9 of my guide for RotaryCraft. A couple quick things before I get started. Firstly, I'm going to approach this episode a little bit differently than the rest. You'll see I only have this little part set up. I'm going to do one item at a time and then combine all the clips together so I can have a better estimate about how much time I'm spending on the episode. It's more for the purposes of me keeping count than anything else. So if I don't get to as many things as you like are in one category from here on as I possibly should have based on how many things are on a page or whatever, it's because I'm trying to sort of minimize the time. Anyway, the other thing is apparently someone managed to point out that I have been doing a RotaryCraft guide to Reika themselves. Reika is the maker of RotaryCraft and ReactorCraft and ElectroCraft and a bunch of other really fun mods. And Reika has been commenting on my videos and giving me some updated information and fixing some of the mistakes or the parts that I may have left out. So always, before you think I may have misspoken, which does happen from time to time, especially when I'm reading this, because, for instance, that right there, my brain keeps telling me it looks like a comma, so I change that to the next step up, when in fact that is, as far as I am able to tell now, a decimal point. I will try to remember that that's a decimal point, 524.288 kilowatts, not 524,288 kilowatts. Anyway, those numbers I tend to goof up on. The ones that I have on the signs, like these, for instance, are typically spot on, maybe off by one in one direction or another, but I try to get them exact if I can. But if something may be wrong, or you think I missed something or whatever, check the comments, because it is very likely that Reika will have added the missing information. One last thing before I get on with this part here. This is being done for RotaryCraft version 23B. There have been a few versions since then, but I'm doing it inside the constraints of the default configuration, regular monster mod pack, and Feed the Beast. I haven't changed any of the config files. I haven't taken any mods out or added any mods, anything like that. It's just the current recommended version, so it's not even really the latest version. It's the one that's recommended. When a later version of Monster comes out that has a later version of RotaryCraft, if anything is drastically changed that hasn't been covered, say in the comments or in the description, I will go ahead and add some more information at the end of that. But from here on out, keep in mind that other information is probably available in the comments section. But anyway, time to move on to the first thing here. This is called the Bedrock Breaker, and the recipe for that there is some HSLA or NHSLA steel, three base panels, two diamonds, and three obsidian. Nothing too terribly fancy, does have to be made in a work table. And for what it does, it's actually really not all that expensive of a recipe. And in it, as a matter of fact, the power consumption really isn't all that high either, just the bare minimum to get it running. Let's change that to daytime real quick. First thing to note about it is it can be set in all six directions, so it can be facing up, down, left, right, sideways, whatever, which means you can dig down on these flat worlds. In a previous video, I had mentioned that it would be hard to get bedrock on some of the mod packs maps, and that's because I thought that on these super flat, it has these four levels of bedrock, and on the regular normal world generation, I thought it only had the bottom layer, so I did not realize immediately that you could get the bedrock from these maps, or from the maps that have these flat bedrock areas. But as a matter of fact, you can, because there's more than one layer. Now, the reason why you can't get the bottom layer is, if you come over to page 8, it says this right here. The machine will not break the bedrock at layer 8. Now, this says a 4-block range. This might be corrected in a later version, or this might be wrong. I don't know. I'm sure Reika will mention it, but I have found it to be a 5-block range. And what this thing does, lag there. Uh-oh. All right. Not entirely sure what happened there, but I went ahead and restarted my Minecraft. That seemed to fix it. Anyway, I believe I was about to do this here. What the rock breaker does is, if you have bedrock in front of it, it has to be directly in front of it, in front of that part there. Doesn't work if it's below it or anywhere else other than where it's facing. Any of these blocks it'll ignore, but I am going to put this here for a reference. It will... Actually, I can just put that one there. What this thing will do is slowly chip away at the bedrock itself and start turning it into bedrock dust. Now, the bare minimums to get this thing running are 8,192 newton meters of torque and 64 radians per second of output of the speed. And if you look there, it does one slice, I guess is the correct term for it. Let's see here, is that called? Yeah, bedrock slice. It does one slice every almost 21 seconds at the lowest setting. But when it does, you can see here, it chips away a little bit of the bedrock. It's still not a block that you can pick up, but it is slowly chipping away at it, one little bit at a time, once every 21 seconds. But that's not fast enough. If you want it to go at absolute maximum speed, the bare minimum amount of speed that you're going to need is 1,223 radians per second. So, whoops. At that speed there, it's working at 10 seconds per operation. But if I go that one extra piece, it's, or not 10 seconds, but 1/10 of a second, that one extra piece, putting it up at the 1,223, is once every tick it does an operation. Now, what it did with this bedrock is kind of interesting. Let me go ahead and turn this off here. I should mention, it, as you can see on the sign, it does not overload. You could, that could be all nines and it wouldn't explode, so that's something nice. When it digs the bedrock, each bedrock will produce, if you right-click on this thing, you can get these, this bedrock dust. And there were 5 of them there, so 4 bedrock dust apiece is 20 bedrock dust. Now, the bedrock dust is useful for it itself for crafting recipes within RotaryCraft, but also, if you take it over to a blast furnace or an induction smelter and have a steel ingot in it and then crank the blast furnace up to 1,000 degrees. I'm just using a friction heater there, by the way. And once it gets up to 1,000 degrees Celsius, this little arrow will start turning white. Da-da-da. Has to be in that spot. There we go. This will turn white, and with 4 bedrock dust and the 1 steel ingot, you will get 1 bedrock ingot. Let's turn off the noisemaker there. Now, this bedrock ingot is useful for several other things. It is used in a couple of recipes for some of the devices. But more importantly, you can make tools, weapons, and armor out of them. Real quick, the bedrock dust, one of the more important things you're probably going to use it for is the bedrock shaft unit, and show you the recipe for that. That's a regular shaft unit and one bedrock's worth of dust, but it'll get you four of them, so it's a little bit kinder there. But the recipes for these things, bedrock helmet, which will give you projectile protection 4, is the same recipe as most other helmets. And then same thing with the chest plate, same sort of recipe. That's blast protection 4. Leggings are fire protection 4 and feather falling 4 for the boots. And then the weapons are made the same, and tools are made the same way. We've got silk touch 1 on the pickaxe, which is nice because it's really sharp. And that's a typical recipe there, only instead of normal sticks, it takes shaft units. Same thing for all the other tools, it's shaft units instead. The shears, likewise, 2 bedrock ingots, and then the sword, 2 ingots, 1 shaft unit, will get you a sharpness 5, looting 5 bedrock sword. And all of the bedrock stuff has infinite durability, it will not break down, you don't have to worry about it degrading over time, so once you get it, you've got it. No having to repair it or anything like that. So those are several of the reasons that you're going to want to aim for getting this bedrock breaker. On to the next item. Alright, the next device that we have here is called a boring machine. Actually, I think I had one in the chest. Yep. And what this boring machine does is it will dig in front of it in a pretty large area for an incalculably long distance. It'll just keep on going. But real quick, you're going to need one of these drills. And that's just some steel ingots. And you can do that in a regular crafting table. You don't need a work table for that. And the boring machine, you do need a work table. And it uses that drill, 3 more ingots, some base panels, 2x gear unit, and a circuit board. Now, this thing, when you place it down, let me get out the screwdriver here. It will turn any of the 4 main directions, but it does not go up and down. And that's probably for the reason that there are other blocks that will be able to dig down, which I will be covering later. But this thing is pretty cool. Here's the GUI for it. Real quick, let me show you what's in the book here, again with the recipe. One thing it mentions is that it requires more power and torque to dig. 640 watts per hardness point of the block in front of it. And for the most part, you're only going to need to get up to 512 newton meters of torque. But there are some blocks that break these general rules, because they are a lot harder and will need a bit more oomph to break through. So these are just kind of basic guidelines. Also, unless you know the hardnesses of the items off the top of your head, or you have some sort of device that can just tell you the hardness of something, that's going to be pretty hard to figure out. So for the most part, you're just going to want to just pump this thing with enough juice to get going through most of the materials you're going to encounter, depending on what world you're in, and let it go for a while. Now, it does require, for the most part, 512 newton meters of torque to dig through just about anything, including obsidian. So I have this preset to 512, and I have this set to 512, and you'll see something about that in just a moment. The last couple things I wanted to cover before I get it started. There are a whole bunch of buttons here. And what these determine is the area that it will dig. So if I do this, it'll dig the bottom row in front of it. If I do this, it'll dig the bottom row and that. If I, for instance, go ahead, oops, and fill all these in, it will dig all of them. This button here, drops on or off, means whether or not it will actually produce materials as it digs. If you have this cranked up really high, you're going to be getting thousands of items a second, and you might not be able to deal with all of them. So watch out for that. But this one here, reset position, basically what that means is the plane right here in front of the device, I have it facing this way, and that plane right there is the square one of the digging operation. So when you press that button on the next cycle, it will reset its boring location to this plane right there. Now I have all of these on, and I have this set to 512 and 512. So let's see what that accomplishes. Clang, clang, clang. Now that's because it is trying to dig the entire area that I have laid out all at once, and it doesn't have enough juice to do that. So let's just go ahead and give it a little bit more juice, just because. Still nothing. Let's reset the position. Oh, you can see that. There, turn that off. You can see that even though I set, hit the reset position button, it's not doing anything. And also, the timer up there, the operation time, let me kick it off for just a moment. Up at the top, it says almost 4 seconds. Ah, hard to talk over that. Almost 4 seconds. And the more speed you give it, the faster it'll process. So let's give this a little bit more juice just to see what happens. The next stage above that, let's see here, that is 65. I can't do that in my head. Okay. 131072. Still not doing it. Not resetting. Now you can hear a pause between every one of those actions, and that's because it resets its internal timer to the operation time, and the faster, the more juice you give it, the faster it will go through its cycle. But if it can't do anything, it'll just reset the clunking. So let's go ahead and double this. Actually, why not? Let's set it for the maximum. The amount of speed that you're going to want to cap out here, this won't explode, but the point at which it reaches one operation per tick, which is as fast as the display shows, is that speed right there, 253214. So let's go ahead and set this to 253214 and skip all the hullabaloo. And nothing's happening. Reset the position. What's going on? Hold on, let's make it daytime. For some reason, it just doesn't like to have stuff in front of it directly. So let's go ahead and clear this out. But this is not always the case. I haven't figured out the exact criteria for how it wants to do, and you can see that's what the front looks like, and it does receive power through the back. I should mention that. But let's go ahead and turn this back on, and immediately it will produce this wall here, and that is the maximum size of this right there, but it is not actually digging forward any, so let's reset the position to the front. And then come all the way down here. I just want to show you this. I have a piece of bedrock here. And that's because, for the most part, it's not going to dig through bedrock. It can, under certain conditions. Ooh. Bunch of lag there for a second. Alright. Let's turn this off. Break that. And even outside of creative, it one punch will break all that. Now, it hasn't done any digging in here. And I'm going to... just to show you this here. Bring the size down. Now, the reason why I'm doing all these different things is to show you that, well, in part, it has different power requirements for different varieties of things. And also to show you some of the different things you're going to encounter as you're messing with it. But I'll leave the torque there. Let's see what happens. Reset the position. Turn it on. And look at it go. I set it to the maximum speed. And so you can see here it says... operation time 0.05 seconds. That's one thing per tick. Let's come down here. Take a look at the bedrock. Now, the way this works is it sends out these little mining pipes that you can't harvest, but it shoots out directly in front of it in a straight line for an immensely long distance. I've had it go for thousands of blocks before I turned it off, and I didn't actually realize it would go so far out of chunk range, so I chased it down for a good long time. But when you break one of them, it breaks a whole bunch at once. And I'll just go ahead and show you that here. Clunk. Clunk. Yes, I know, cave noise, clunk. Now, it still thinks it's left off over there, so let's go ahead and reset this just to show you that. Once again, it has gone all the way back here to the bedrock. Now, let's make the area a little bigger. Oh, before I get too far ahead of myself... I have on the top of its digging area some sand and some gravel, and I will show you why soon enough, but I just want you to keep that in mind. Let's set this to... I'll just go ahead and set it to this. And reset the position. It does spit out the items from the top. You can, use a vacuum or a golem or... some hoppers or whatever it is you want to use to deal with them, but it does just spray them out. It doesn't have an inventory. Let me turn this off now. Come in here and break these guys. Once again, you can see it stops at the bedrock. It converted the sand into sandstone and the gravel into stone, and this is so situations like when you're digging under something that has sand and or gravel, it won't fill in the tunnel after you break everything out and have a whole bunch of stuff come crashing down. So it does automatically replace, and that's a wonderful thing. But I had thought about showing you that it does just keep going forever, but I think you get the picture. It will go for thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of blocks if you're not paying attention, if you're giving it enough power, and you'll have to deal with all of this potential income of items. It can become quite a mess. Let me go ahead and get rid of these. Now, some other real quick information about this before I let let you go for this part. I have a maze stone from the Twilight Forest mod. This guy requires a bit more oomph. If I give it 3,071 newton meters of torque and reset the position, come on. Well, as you can see, it's not doing anything. So, as soon as I break it, it goes. So let's reset the position again and set it up to 3072. Automatically, there it went. Boogity, boogity. And it is done with that area. Now, one other thing. The maze stone, the labyrinth in the Twilight Forest, the bottom part of it is encased in a bedrock material. And in order to break it, apparently you are going to need that much oomph. Let's go ahead and reset the position. Okay, why aren't you... Does it have to be in the Twilight for that to work? I think it might have to be in the Twilight. Let's go find out. I'll be right back. Okay, I didn't want to record transporting between the different ages because sometimes I get a lag crash while I'm recording when it happens. But I went ahead and found one over here, and this is how I came across the number. Way down here at the end of this little tunnel, I set up a little boring machine here. Let me get this out. And is that? Yeah, that's facing the right way. Is that not going to do it? Oh, right. There we go. Now, at that speed, it is right. Let me come up next to it. Oops. It's right there, so I'm going to go ahead and up it just a bit. There we go. Shouldn't take too terribly long. And this is the same bedrock that I had in the overworld. So I'm thinking that this only matters in the Twilight. There we go. It broke it. And it is putting off 2 bedrock dust per bedrock. So I guess it only matters when it's actually in the Twilight Forest. There you go. So I'm going to cut here, get back to the surface, and see if there's anything else I need to cover on this, and then I will be back. All right, yeah, that's the exact same bedrock. I actually went ahead and did the whole click on the ground thing and grabbed it from there and put those there. So it is exactly the same bedrock that's from the Twilight Forest. So it doesn't work on digging bedrock in the overworld. I presume that's intentional, but you do need 8192 newton meters of torque to do that. All right. Now, one other thing to mention about this. Once you have some of this in place and you might want to add another location, all you have to do is reset and it will dig until you tell it to stop, either by way of bedrock, if you can manage to have some in the way, or until it runs out of power. So it will go the whole distance and stop, and you don't need to break this to get rid of that. You just need to reset. And you can see there's another one. But anyway, that is the boring machine. And it is probably going to be just about the fastest way you're going to be getting resources. So I'm going to go ahead and cut here, and I will be right back. All right. It looks like that's going to have to be it for this episode. It's gotten about to the half hour point. So I'm going to just go ahead and cut here. Thank you very much for watching. If you have any questions, comments, or suggestions, please feel free to leave a comment in the comment section below, and I will do my best to get back to you as quick as I can. If you like this video and you like what I'm doing here, please feel free to give a like. I do appreciate that. And if you haven't already, go ahead and subscribe so you know when my future stuff comes out. But I need to get to work on some more of these devices. So thank you once again for watching. This is Thorn of Night, and I will talk to you later.